So let's talk about those gymnosperms for a bit. There are significant plants in our world today, at least some of them are, and they're also an obvious starting point for discussions on angiosperm evolution. The four groups, as you'll remember, are cycads, ginkgos, conifers, and neophytes. And we'll take these groups on in sequence, starting with the cycads, cycadophyta. Now, I'm starting with cycads because they're both the earliest group of gymnosperms to appear in the fossil record, and also because they have the most fern-like appearance of the four types of gymnosperm. Now, most people look at a cycad and think, hey, that looks like a palm tree, but really, they don't. Yeah, the most widely known cycad, Cycas revoluta, which is a very common fixture of landscaping in areas where it doesn't freeze, like Southern California, also goes by the common name of sago palm. But palms are flowering plants. Cycas is not a flowering plant, but instead it produces either long male cones, this is a cone from a plant growing in front of my mom's house, or it produces these short fat cones like we're seeing here that will eventually be producing the seeds. Now, like most gymnosperms, cycads are dioecious, meaning that you have two sexes of plant, which will be either male and produce only staminate cones, like the long one that I showed you before, or it will be female and produce ovulate cones. Apart from the sexual differences, all cycads have a very similar appearance, and maybe I won't be able to convince you that they don't look like palm trees, but look at this. Now, to me, this plant has a much stronger resemblance to a fern than to a palm tree. It kind of looks like an ancient seed fern of the late Paleozoic or early Mesozoic. As I said before, cycads are the earliest known gymnosperms with fossils as old as the Carboniferous, and they actually become significant players in the forest later, in the Permian, and they continue to be important right on through the Cretaceous. So yes, cycads would have been a very important food item for the herbivorous dinosaurs. Are cycads edible today? Well, sort of. They're used for starch, and in fact the word sago is a local name for the flower that comes from the stems of palms and cycads. Now you should note that cycads are laced with toxins, and especially the seeds, which are bright red-orange, are very dangerous to have around if you have pets that might be inclined to eat things that they find in the shrubbery. So the ginkgophyta, as you can see here, is the sister group to the cycadophyta. Today there's only one living species of ginkgo, Ginkgo biloba, or the maidenhair tree, which was probably saved from extinction by Japanese monks who were traveling through China, and they returned to Japan with ginkgo seeds to plant in their monasteries at home. Meanwhile, over in China, the aboriginal stands of ginkgos were destroyed by the advance of human civilization. Now, they're pretty extensively used in landscaping, like the one in this picture, though only the male trees are usually allowed to live, because the females produce seeds that are surrounded by a foul-smelling integument, and these seeds fall to the ground in massive quantities through late summer and early fall. There's also a largely unregulated industry of herbal supplements based on the extracts from ginkgo leaves. Now, ginkgos have a very characteristic leaf morphology, and their fossil record goes back to the early Permian, possibly the late Carboniferous. One more thing is that ginkgos and cycads share the characteristic of having swimming sperm cells rather than pollen tubes, and we'll get to this later. Okay, next up are the conifers, and conifers are, I hope, pretty obviously the things that you normally think of as cone-bearing plants. Pines, firs, cedars, and spruces, as well as maybe some things that you might not know had cones. Junipers, for instance, have berries that are actually young female cones. Now, as far as the name for the group goes, both coniferophyta and pinophyta are used. Coniferophyta is the older term, but there's a rule in plant nomenclature that taxonomic ranks are supposed to be named after the type taxon of the next lower rank. In this case, there's a long string of taxonomic names that are all based on the same root word. For example, the Pinaceae is the family that gets its name from the genus Pinus, which includes several species of tree, including the rarest of all American pines, Pinus toriana, found only on the bluffs overlooking the ocean at La Jolla. The order Pinales gets its name from the family Pinaceae, which, being the first named of the families, gets to have its name carried up to the ordinal level. And then the class Pinopsida is so named because of the Pinellis. It's kind of like we're following the rules to name the phylum Pinophyta after the class Pinopsida, which is named after the Pinellis, which is named after the family Pinaceae, Pinus, and so forth. But in this particular case, I think there's a general trend among botanists to kind of prefer the older term Coniferophyta. And I think this might be based on the argument that changing this particular name really doesn't give us a huge advantage of clear insight. Anyways, we're talking about the conifers. And like the cycads and the ginkgos, conifers also have fossils going all the way back to the Carboniferous. And there's also a decent likelihood that an ancient group of earlier Carboniferous plants, the cordites, were a stem group that were actually connected. They led to the Coniferophyta. And if this is the case, it might push the latest possible date for the origin of Gymnosperms back by a few million years. Now, in addition to being the most common and familiar of gymnosperms, coniferophytes are also very significant in the global economy of carbon, making up a significant proportion of the Earth's standing biomass. The boreal forests of North America, Europe, and Asia are predominantly coniferous, and in the southern hemisphere's higher latitudes, that means further south towards the pole, you have other kinds of conifers that look rather different from ours, like this Araucaria araucana. Okay? It's sometimes called the monkey puzzle tree. It's a really interesting looking plant. And this is the kind of conifer that we find predominantly in the southern hemisphere, Norfolk Island, Australia, New Zealand, South America. Now the fourth group of gymnosperms is going to be the Nidophyta. It's a silent G. And there are actually three very different groups of plants that are still around that are part of the Nidophyta. The first group is called Nitum, and it's a pretty nondescript group of tropical woody plants, shrubs, and small trees, and for the life of me, I can't find anything interesting to say about them. So I'm going to skip them and move directly over to Ephedra, or Ephedra. Now the Ephedras are a group of twig-like plants that tend to like very arid habitats, like the deserts. In the United States, we have Mormon tea, which was actually used for a hot, stimulating beverage by Native Americans, as well as the Mormon pioneers. Now, one of the closely related species, Ephedra sinica, also known as mahuang, is well known for its abundant production of the alkaloids ephedrine and pseudoephedrine, which are used in over-the-counter medications, as well as in the synthesis of illegal methamphetamines. Now, like so many other gymnosperms, the dioecious Ephedra produces male cones and female cones separately. What we're looking at here is a male cone. And despite the superficial resemblance of this structure to maybe a cluster of flowers on a flowering plant, the nidophyte cone is actually very different from what you find in all flowering plants. And we'll be talking about the flowering plant synapomorphies in an upcoming video. The third kind of nidophyte is Welwitschia mirabilis. There's only one species in the whole group. It's native to the coastal deserts of Western Africa, where the annual rainfall is effectively zero. Welwitschia plants get some moisture from a root system that penetrates very, very deeply, but usually it depends on the coastal fog that rolls in off the Atlantic. Another cool fact about Welwitschia is that this is a plant with only two leaves that continue to grow from the leaf base. And these succulent leaves make up the bulk of the plant's above-ground biomass. Some individuals in Namibia are estimated to be several hundred years old, based on the thickness of the leaves at their base. If you ever get to a good botanical garden, that is one that's not just about topiaries and English roses, look in the greenhouses for strange plants like Welwitschia. So now that you have some faces to go along with our four named groups of gymnosperms, let's talk a bit about the ways in which they're different from each other, and in particular, we're going to focus on the ways that some groups have some very interesting and historically confusing similarities with angiosperms. Now let me be very clear that the four gymnosperm groups are more closely related to each other. These four share a more recent common ancestor compared with the ancestor that they share with angiosperms. So if there's a characteristic that makes one of these gymnosperm groups similar to angiosperms, there are really two possibilities. Either that character was there with the original ancestor and was lost on whatever gymnosperm groups don't have it now, or the character evolved twice, independently in both angiosperms as well as in the gymnosperm taxon. Let's take as our first example the one I started to talk about a little earlier. It has to deal with the mode by which the sperm travels to the megagametophyte. This happens after the pollen grain has already managed to fly through the air from the male cone over onto the ovulate cone on the female plant. Okay? So the pollen, which is the male gametophyte, is already there, very close to the destination, but it still needs to get its sperm to the egg cell, which is going to be somewhere deeper within the female cone. Now there are two systems for doing this, and I'm going to use the ginkgo to illustrate the first one. Okay? In ginkgos and cycads, this is a ginkgo up here, the female gametophyte squeezes out a little pollination droplet, a small droplet of sugary liquid. And the pollen, which is airborne, lands on the pollination droplet and sticks there. It's kind of like flypaper. And after a short while, the female cone will draw that pollination droplet back into the pollination chamber. And that's where the pollen is going to be trapped. Okay? What happens at that point is that the pollen will start to sprout little rootlets. They'll take anchor in the wall of the female gametophyte. And then the little red thing that I've drawn here, it's the sperm. And what happens, the sperm starts to move around faster and faster, and eventually it breaks out from the pollen. And at that point, it can swim over to find the micropyle and eventually get to the egg where fertilization is going to take place. Okay? Okay, this system is called zooidogamy. And again, it's found in the cycads and the ginkgos. In the second system, which is used by conifers, anemophytes, and angiosperms, there's no stage of free-swimming sperm cells. Instead, the pollen lands on a sticky surface, and then a pollen tube grows out from the pollen grain and extends in the direction of the female gametophyte. Okay. So here's the pollen tube, and it's growing into the megagametophyte, and then the sperm cell, the sperm nucleus, is then delivered directly to the egg. And this system of using a pollen tube is called siphonogamy. And again, it's characteristic of the conifers and the neophytes and the angiosperms. Now, it's very unlikely that siphonogamy, the use of pollen tubes, was ancestral there at the beginning for all seed plants, because all the ferns and all the other basal plants use motile sperm cells. Moreover, the fossils that we have of early seed plants, like Alkinsia and all different kinds of seed ferns, they show female cones with pollen chambers, and this suggests motile sperm. So let's go ahead and presume zooidogamy to be the ancestral state. And the only explanation that really works for us is that siphonogamy evolved twice. Once here, along the lineage leading to the angiosperms, okay, zooidogamy to siphonogamy, and so that we have siphonogamy in the case of the angiosperms, and then again right here, zooidogamy, siphonogamy, so that we can see the distribution of siphonogamy in the coniferophytes, the neophytes, and the angiosperms, whereas the cycads and the ginkgos are basically retaining the ancestral characteristic of zooidogamy. Now, as a second example, there are two modes of fertilization seen in seed plants: single fertilization and double fertilization. In cycads and ginkgos and conifers, fertilization takes place as you would expect it to. Each pollen grain delivers one sperm cell that fuses with one egg to make a single zygote. Single fertilization. The zygote is the thing that grows up to make the next sporophytic plant generation. Now, in double fertilization, which is seen in neophytes and angiosperms, each pollen grain delivers what is effectively two sperm cells, while each ovule or female gametophyte or megagametophyte has two or sometimes three eggs. And I'm going to show you the pattern with three eggs because it's what we see in most angiosperms. Now, to be perfectly precise, only one of these is a true egg, and the other two are really just a pair of haploid nuclei in what's called the central cell of the megagametophyte. But don't worry about those details. Okay? The fertilization is a double fertilization event because two zygotes form. In one fertilization, you have one sperm and the true egg fusing to form a diploid zygote. And then in the other fertilization, this second sperm cell fuses with the other two haploid nuclei to make a triploid. Only the first zygote, the diploid, will develop into the next sporophytic plant generation, while the other triploid embryo is going to take on a role in supporting the development of the first embryo. We used to use this fact that Neophytes share this characteristic of double fertilization with flowering plants as an argument in support of the proposal that Neophyta in angiosperms shared a more recent common ancestor than did Neophyta with the rest of the gymnosperms. But we know now this isn't the case. It's kind of like in our previous example, we have to assume that this ancestral plant here had single fertilization, right? Single fertilization is characteristic of plants generally, and it's only these two groups out here, the neophytes and the angiosperms, that have double fertilization. Single fertilization is characteristic of the cycads, it's characteristic of the ginkophytes, it's characteristic of the conifers, okay? And the best way for us to understand double fertilization is that we had two different switches from single fertilization over to double fertilization. One occurring right here along the neophyte lineage and one occurring over here along the lineage leading to the angiosperms, so that we end up with two lineages, double fertilization with the neophytes, double fertilization with the angiosperms. So now let's bring in some paleoecology to help us understand a possible reason for these character state changes from motile sperm to pollen tubes and from single to double fertilization. These changes occurring twice in two separate lineages. And honestly, we don't know when these things evolved in the angiosperm lineage because the fossil record for the angiosperms is just so poor. Remember, this is the group of plants that went AWOL on us for 180 million years. But it's entirely possible that it could have happened at similar times and under similar selective pressures to what happened with the evolution of these same characteristics in the gymnosperms. And this would coincide with the late Carboniferous and early Permian drying out of the Earth's climate. Now remember, we have global cooling, and simply dropping the temperatures would reduce the total amount of precipitation falling on the planet. But this was also coupled with the conversion of much of the world's land area to an arid Pangean interior, far away from the world's oceans, which would have been the source of any kind of atmospheric moisture. In other words, we've got a really massive desert in the middle of this gigantic continent. And this would have put a lot of selective pressures on those plants who are needing to adapt to these drier conditions. We already know that conifers and neophytes are gymnosperm groups that did better under these drier and cooler conditions. You can look at their distributions today. They're in high latitudes, and they tend to lean towards the deserts. Now, if you're looking at the angiosperms, we're kind of looking at a different story. From the first angiosperms we start seeing in the Cretaceous, they've certainly done very, very well in the wet equatorial zones. But one hypothesis for the disappearance of fossils from the angiosperm lineage is they persisted in the drier habitats where fossilization rates are especially poor. And so it's an attractive idea that pollen tubes and double fertilization, they might confer some advantage under these more severe conditions to which these groups, the neophytes, the conifers, and those missing angiosperms, were adapting during this period of dryness. To summarize, in this video we started off with a quick survey of the four phyla of gymnosperms. Then we described pollen tubes and double fertilization and how they evolved independently in both gymnosperms and angiosperms. And now from this point onwards, we're going to be focusing more intently on the angiosperms specifically and their evolution.